Live from his luxury penthouse apartment in London's glittering East End, Dean Lerner, club owner, entrepreneur, and publisher of high-class gentlemen's magazines, invites you to join him for an exclusive man-to-man.
Good evening and welcome to Man to Man with Dean Lerner, where each week I'll give you an exclusive invite to my £5 million penthouse apartment and introduce you to one of my VIP friends from the world of the arts slash entertainment. And what a guest I have for you tonight. I first met him when I was working at a horror publishing house called Beelzebooks. Now, my background had been in high-quality, upmarket erotica for the discerning connoisseur, so I wondered, understandably, whether I'd feel at home at a company that dealt exclusively in horror. Well, I had no idea how quickly the horror community, and it is a community, how quickly the horror community would wake up to the idea of scary porn. I wanted to release books that would give the reader a boner, but leave him too terrified to do anything about it. Within the week, I'd coined the phrase books that will scare you stiff. We'd opened up a new Horotica division, and our sales just went silly. How could things get any better? Well, I'll tell you for how. I met a young, hungry, vital writer called Garth Marenghi, and we fell in like at first sight. Thenceforth started a writer-publisher relationship that has continued to this day and has developed into one of the most important and meaningful friendships of my life, certainly in financial terms. How could I sum up this titan of terror, this Grand Duke of Darkness? It'd take me an eternity, which I quite simply don't have. So, please welcome Sir Splatter himself, the Fright Honourable, Garth Marenghi.
Can I just say that when I entered there, the floor should have been entirely covered in dry ice to give the impression that I don't have feet. So, just bear in mind I may or may not have hooves.
Cool. That's Sasu's fault. I made the mistake of giving her an additional task. Are you all right there?
Yes, Dean.
OK, and remember, if you get frightened with any of this talk of horror, just pop your earmuffs on.
OK. Okay.
All right. Yeah. OK, no, not yet, Sasu. No, oh, she's gone. She's gone. Sasu's my primary partner, by the way. I'm having actually to downsize the harem here at Dean Towers because I'm converting some of the girls' bedrooms into an indoor skating rink. Sorry, Garth. Now, it's an historic occasion today, and I'm truly humbled to be hosting it because this is Garth's first public appearance since his terrible accident, of which more in the Dunus, of course, if you feel able.
Perhaps.
You look marvellous, by the way. The surgery's been really well done. Which one is a new ear?
Pardon?
Yeah, pardon. Lovely. That's priceless. Oh. You've kept your sense of humour, which is so wonderful.
Well, you have to, don't you? You have to.
I mean, when people come up to me and they say, what is Garth Marenghi like? They expect me to describe this dark figure. You know, he writes these twisted, brilliant but very gory horror stories like Stump or Ripper. The guy must be sick. But you have provided me with more hootage than any man I know, with the possible exception of Freddie Starr.
Well, you know, it's been my lifeline over the last few months, Dean. I've been blessed with Gallowsian humour. In fact, as I said to you before I came out, I think I've broken every bone in my body except my funny bone. So, I thought that would get a better response. But anyway, it's like when I was in the ambulance going to the hospital. I was still up for the crack, was I not? And the ambulance driver turned round at one point and he said, "Please, Mr. Marenghi, will you stop talking or we're going to crash? What you're saying is that funny."
I can vouch for that because I was in the ambulance with you and I thought I was going to die. I said they're going to have to get two body bags ready. This guy's critically ill and I'm dying of laughter.
This show's wonderful, Dean. It's such a reflection of the wit and sophistication that's in you.
Thank you for that unprompted compliment. Now, let's talk about what you were doing at the start of the year, if we may, before what happened.
Sure. Well, in early January, I wrote Return of the Coil, about a woman who circumnavigates the portals of hell via a cursed contraceptive device. In late Jan, I wrote the sequel, Return of the Coil 2, Re-entry. In early Feb, Hellbent, my novella about a homosexual demon searching for acceptance within his own diabolical community, came out, both literally and figuratively.
Yeah. And there was a bit of a hold-up with that one, wasn't there, at the printers, because we originally wanted everything printed on black rubber, but that meant you needed to apply talc each time you turned a page, and in the end, we thought it was a bit tacky, it was a bit Route 1, so we ended up going for a glittery dust jacket with complimentary nipple ring, which I...
Yeah.
Which I thought works well.
No, it does. It does. And then late Feb, the two sequels came out. That was Hellbenders and Hellbenders 2, The Boys Are Back.
And you've got a new book coming out now. Let's have a squiz at a clip.
You know, it frightens me how many novels of terror I've written. Now you can buy all 436 in one easy-to-read volume.
From Garth Marenghi, who brought you Slicer, Slasher, Ripper, and many more. Comes Garth Marenghi's The Earth. With a reinforced spine made from genuine cat bone. It comes complete with these detachable balancing sticks, allowing you to read safely, and adjustable brackets for easy storage. Order now and you receive this attachable index and chapter one of Garth's new novel.
If you only buy one Garth Marenghi book, buy this one, which is all of them.
Garth Marenghi's The Earth, the only book you'll ever need.
It's a phenomenal work, right? How do you manage it, Garth? How do you keep getting inspiration?
Cheese. I eat a lot of cheese, which gives me these fantastic, vivid dreams. You know, a lot of writers will smoke pot. If I hit a wall, I'll generally reach for the Emmental or the Dolce Latte. Wash those down with beer and pickles, have a nap, wake up, chap two awaits. The only downside is I tend to put on 2 stone a novel. But if you type as fast as I do, you can generally sweat out a stone of that, so it evens out more or less.
I'm exactly the same with mackerel. I mean, I can't stop at one. I'll eat 4 or 5 at a sitting. So I always make sure I forewarn my dining companion, you know, that I'll need at least an hour for things to settle afterwards, cos the last thing anyone wants is for that mackerel to re-emerge during the physical act of love.
Well, you know, you're very lucky with your metabolism, Dean, because I think mackerel would sit very heavily on me.
Yes.
I mean, I was approached to be the face of Ginster's Pies, which is hugely flattering, of course, but I had to turn it down because the sheer number of freebies would have been a death sentence. And at the end of the day, I'm not a salesman either. I'm a shaman. I'm a dream weaver. My job is to question, like Poe Edgar Allan, is all we see or seen but a dream within a dream?
I don't know. What did he say?
I don't think he had an answer, to be honest. I think that was the point, you know, are you real?
Yes.
But are you?
Oh, stop it, Garth, you're creeping me out.
Perhaps you're asleep and this is a nightmare. How do you know you exist?
Wow, it's interesting, isn't it? It's like that philosophical question, you know, if a tree falls in the forest and I'm not there and it makes a sound, but I don't hear it, but someone records it and plays it to me at a dinner party, does that mean I'm still in the forest? And if I am, then why can't I just take a piss in the garden rather than queuing for the toilet? And that's if the toilet even exists. I've been trying to use it all fucking night. I'm starting to doubt the existence of the toilet, quite frankly, at this stage of the proceedings.
You see? Can you feel it? You see, I'm getting you to
get
ask
a portaloo,
questions.
Is what I'm saying. If you're going to have a party of that size, get a portaloo. Because I don't want to spend my entire fucking evening in the corridor. And if philosophy can solve those questions, then it's worth it. But thus far it can't. So I'm fucking busting. And what's Plato doing about it? Nothing.
You see? You see, you're asking questions.
Mm, I am. My mind's abuzz with possibilities. It's like peeling an onion. But it still doesn't answer the question. It still doesn't answer the question, does it, Garth, as to why horror? Couldn't you do the same kind of questioning in whodunits or porno?
Well, how long's a piece of string?
That's true.
I've always been attracted to the dark side of life. You know, at school, some boys would pull the wings off flies. I'd also perform autopsies. I think it's cathartic for me. I think if I wasn't writing, I'd probably be out in the streets right now carving people up. But I see myself as a ferryman. Society is my cargo. You, Dean, are the first mate.
All aboard. But you, as well as being a writer, are an actor and a director.
Correct.
And you were working on a feature film.
Correct.
Called War of the Wasps.
You've earned yourself a third correct.
And I remember very clearly reading the script, and I said to you, Garth, I said, I love this. I love this script. I was sick twice, and then I got the runs. We have to make this movie. What gave you the idea?
Well, one day I saw a wasp, and I thought, what if that wasp waged war? And then the piece really wrote itself.
Sure. And could you describe the general premise of the film?
Sure. Well, I play Ken Douglas, a renegade insectologist and part-time horror writer who is thrown out of the Romford Creepy Crawly Institute for his radical paper on Daddy Longlegs. He's then drafted into the Secret Service counter-insect unit to fight off what turns out to be an invasion of giant cosmic wasps. And to cut a long story short, Douglas ends up luring them into outer space via a giant sticky bun.
Sure, sure. And are the wasps a metaphor?
A metaphor what?
No, sorry. A metaphor.
Yes, let's say they are. You know, we're living in dangerous times, Dean. You know, we're living in a climate of fear. Kin is pitched against kin, and all along we're forgetting what is actually the real threat.
Right, which is?
The Dutch. They look very peaceful. They appear to be keeping themselves to themselves, but I'm watching them, and it's a good job I am because no one else is. And if any aren't too sky-high off home-brewed weed to be watching this, heed my words, I'm on to you.
So, in short, the wasps represent the Dutch?
Yes, they do, because everyone knows that for years now the Dutch have been trying to fuse their kind with wasps to create an insectoidal super soldier. The government are trying to be very, very hush-hush about it. They actually pulled the film from production, which just proves that the Dutch are already running Whitehall.
Sure. And we'll be able to see an exclusive clip of the film the government doesn't want you to see after the break.
Keep watching the skies.
Welcome back to Man with Dean Lerner. I'm joined in the Man Mansionette by Garth Marenghi. And as promised, we're going to show a sequence from War of the Wasps, Garth's allegorical rendering of a potential future war with the Dutch. In this sequence, Ken Douglas...
Whom I play.
..is leading a helicopter attack on the renegade swarm. And if I remember rightly, which I do, your mission objective is to fire a giant canister of insect repellent up the Queen Wasp's back entrance and then detonate it with torpedoes.
Wrong. I actually detonate it using a 30-caliber Browning M1917 A1 hood-mounted machine gun.
Apologies.
Incidentally, for you at home, you probably won't be able to assimilate the density of the imagery in one viewing, so keep up.
Okay. Well, let's take a look.
Thank you.
Charlie, Echo, Bravo, Delta, Sanchez, Bogenhagen, stay close.
How long before the Queen reaches the kidney hospice, Reed?
At the rate she's travelling, I'd guesstimate 2 mins. It's possible that that hospice was built right next to Britain's biggest jam factory, which in turn was constructed next to the Houses of Parliament. And don't forget, Dag, the one woman you love is trapped in there with them. Plus, in addition, a couple of the kids have got whooping cough. Good luck, ladies. I wish I could be up there with you, but I've got a bad back.
You heard the man. Let's take us some Jaspers. Fall in. Minus 3 o'clock. Bogenhagen, back left. Try and go there fast. Sanchez, stick with grip. Let's make him disappear.
Try this for size. Can't shake this one, Dag.
I told you to bog off.
Watch out, the other side.
Dag!
I'm okay. I've lost my repellent, though.
Help! Help!
What is it, Bogenhagen?
Wasps in the cockpit! Help! Too many!
Keep still. Don't annoy them and they'll just fly away.
No, Bogenhagen!
Ah, no!
Bye-bye, Bogenhagen.
Sanch, it's just you and me now, buddy.
Sorry to break up the tender moment, you fart knockers, but there's a killer queen wasp out there that's hornier than a bitch in season, and we need to frag her bug-eyed yellow-bellied hiney before she humps that hospice. So get pronto, Tonto.
Copy that.
I've got her. She's in my sights.
What? Bloody thing's jammed.
I'm gonna have to flap the business out myself.
Sanchez, don't do it.
You know I have to, Dag.
Yep, I guess you do. Look, I'll make sure they build a statue of you right in the middle of Romford. Well, not the middle, we wouldn't get the planning permission, but maybe next to that big Odeon.
Thanks, Dag. I like that big Odeon. Now listen, don't talk. We've not much time. In a minute, you're going to see my chopper hanging out of that Jasper's ass, sir. And you're not going to want to shoot because your best buddy's up there. But you have to, because you'd ask me to do the same thing.
Sorry, Sanj, I didn't get any of that. You're breaking up. Look, I'll just shoot you when you're up there. This is for every time I've tried to drink a can of cider in the park.
Now, since that film, you've turned your considerable gifts to the world of fine arts, and your new exhibition, Imaginata Horrificata, has opened at the Canvey Island Art Centre.
That's right. That's right. And it's been wonderful because we've got people of all shapes and sizes, all ages, all shit for it together. And, you know, sometimes they've actually walked out. It's that terrifying.
Well, that is an achievement. And indeed, sometimes people have been so terrified they haven't even showed up.
See, I take that as a great compliment.
Sure. Did you look to any other artists for inspiration at all?
Not really, no. If I ever want inspiration, I generally reread one of my own books. there's usually something quite profound in there I miss first time. So.
Sure. Well, yeah. I mean, I loved the show. I thought it was tremendous. And what I love so much about it is that you provide very extensive notes alongside the paintings, which is great, because there's no need to interpret them at all. I mean, you know, it's all explained. There's nothing like subtext or anything like that. So I managed to whiz around the whole exhibition in 15 minutes.
Well, that's it. People are very busy, Dean. You know, they don't have time to go to an exhibition and think as well. So, and to be honest, there's nothing worse than a work of art that leaves you asking questions.
Well, believe you me, Garth, I came out of this exhibition with nothing. I was barely thinking.
Thank you.
But the exhibition had to close, didn't it? Because you had an accident.
Yes.
When you were working at your home studio. Do you feel able to discuss this at all?
Well, it's a small thing. It's a silly thing, really. You know.
You're amongst friends, Garth.
Well, I just sculpted a 40-foot statue of my head and it fell on me. So, you know, it could have happened to anyone.
Sure. And I understand that you were actually trapped in your own left nostril for most of the day.
That's right, yeah. When Pam, my wife, came home from work, she cut me out, but I did go for 5 hours without food.
Jesus Christ.
And then I called you to call the private ambulance to take me through to the hospital to test me for concussion, which actually didn't turn out to be concussion, it was just I was hungry.
Sure. And when we were in the ambulance, as we alluded to earlier, you kept cracking these hilarious jokes, yeah. And in the end, the ambulance did crash.
That's right.
And that's when you lost your ear.
That's right. But, you know, that comes with the territory if you're an artist. Mm. You know, if it's good for Vince Van Gee, it's good enough for me.
Sure. And since then, you've been working at your home studio on a new collection, haven't you?
Yeah, and I have to say the new collection's pretty damn primal.
Sure. And we took our man-to-man camera crew, well, cameraman, let's be honest, to document Garth's fresh brush with horror. Come on, that was witty. Unbelievable.
Greetings, traveller, and welcome to my house of horrors. Or perhaps I should say, my converted attic of horrors. I'll come up here in the morning, and the first thing I'll do is I'll strip off, complete them all new, and then I'll try and catch visions. This is entitled Famine, and it's very easy to paint famine, just keep it thin. I don't know if you've seen, but there's a little skull down the bottom here, so any Hamlet fans that are watching, that one's for you. This one over here is called the Taxman. These people are from the VAT office. This one here is a Valentine present to my wife, Pam. It's called Consummation.
This is just paint.
This is my most recent painting. It's my vision of what the family Marenghi would look like without skin. As I've always said, a family that plays together, flies together.
That's the face of a reader deprived of Garth Marenghi novels.
And what these are a cross between my eyeballs and my sperm. So it's my visions that are giving birth and impregnating the minds of millions.
I was so enraged one day, I came in, I just span that. It used to be like that. I just did that. I've never put it back, and I won't.
Now, I must warn you, don't, whatever you do, go in that corner.
No, it's all right, don't. It's just we've got a lamp there.
This has been a short but disturbing journey around my studio dart. Thank you very much for coming. I hope to see you again soon, but for now, get out. Get out, for the demons are coming.
Terrific stuff there, Garth. And you've got a new exhibition, haven't you? Illuminatum Diabolicatum. That's coming soon, isn't mm-hmm. it? And best of luck with that.
Don't need it.
Well, all that remains for me to do is to thank once again my super guest, Garth Marenghi, for talking to me, man to man.
Pleasure.
And to thank you very much for watching. Thank you very much.